started taking all my material, including the humorous stuff, so it's been really nice, and we'll just get on with the content. That would be too easy. So, excuse me while I take down this lovely stuff, but obviously, before I do, I just want to point out that the representation of the harmonic series that you see there is itself, has significant information about symmetry and palindromic, you can observe them very clearly in the way these waves are formed, and sine waves in particular, and all these are, not quite sine waves, but sort of representation of pure waveforms, they themselves exhibit a kind of symmetry which is the can be seen to be, and the harmonic series itself can be seen to be a fundamental acoustical basis for the way music works, generally speaking. I want to not talk too much at first, but play a little music for you with the help of my colleagues in the trio from my piece, just to get us started. But before I do, I want to say something about symmetry that is, I think, important to note right away. Namely that, I'm just curious, how many of you are mathematicians in the audience with backgrounds in mathematics? Quite a few of you. So you'll observe very quickly that my ability to encompass really significant mathematical conceptualizations is limited. And I give the very evident disclaimer to the idea that since many mathematicians are musical, all musicians must have some mathematical skills. I don't think that's a symmetry there, actually. I don't think that actually, that doesn't work. But it is true that as a young musician, I was very, very interested in forces in physics and in mathematics that for which music can be seen to be a kind of representation. So actually, just quickly before we begin, you can see a definition here printed of what symmetry is in math, which has to do with, as according to this definition, that flipping a object of the same size and shape that produces its image, its mirror image in a way, is seen to be symmetrical. And you can see that in a human face or in many objects as well. In physics, symmetry is a little bit different, and in some ways, in my life as a composer, coming to terms with the conceptualization of symmetrical things in the physical world has been even more stimulating to me since I began than the mathematical version. One thing you'll note right away, which gives me a good way to introduce you to what you're about to hear, is that in nature, things that are completely symmetrical across the X and Y axis, which you'll all understand, of course, it's very, very rare that these diamond-like crystalline shapes actually occur. And in fact, symmetry in the world we live, that's terraformed, as it were, is usually a symmetry that is distorted or handed or bent in some significant way. And those of you who have that kind of experience have seen a face in which a photograph was taken of a human face and reversed by the negative so that you might have two left sides of a face joined together to form a whole face. The pure and absolutely perfect symmetry of that face appears as a kind of monstrosity. It's actually horrible to see. And I think the significance of that is, and it does have, you can extrapolate from that into musical realms, and because music, in a sense, is one of the most tactile of the arts. That is, it is one of the most concrete of the arts, even though it's often associated, as Bruce was saying, with fairly significant intellectual manipulations. When you think about it, it's just pressure waves passing by a human ear. They are condensed and rarefied, right, as little waves which then press on the eardrum, sending waves through the ear to trigger little electronic stimuli inside the inner ear eventually, which should suggest to us in a very significant way that music is really closely related to touch, and it is a really, it's a contact sport, as it were. And for all its abstract potentialities, it lives in our world as an anthropomorphic demonstration of humanity in a way, some ways, a little differently than mathematics does and in the world of symmetry does. Our musical symmetries tend to reflect that handedness, that not quite symmetrical beauty that we find perhaps more commonly as a planetary phenomenon. So that being just as an introduction, and I'll come back to some of this again, and I'll be happy to answer questions about it in a moment, but I'd like you to see a little bit of the work that these folks are going to be playing in whole. I'm going to show you a little bit in part. The trio that you are about to hear, I wrote in some ways as my most significant exploration of a kind of rigorous approach to composition, stripping away a lot of historical material, stripping away a lot of the anticipations made by convention and the return of the kind of formalities of music as I had inherited them, and trying to find, perhaps not with the grandeur, but with the same interest as a great architect like Louis Kahn did, find my way back to the elemental nature of music, and then trying to elaborate a music based on my own rules from that most elementary beginning. That's why this piece that you're about to hear, which is in four movements, has these Italian titles, which I should translate for you before we begin. The first movement is called Semplice Inesorabile. It means simply but inexorably. And you'll hear, I think, a kind of inexorable building of something. I won't give away the whole piece except to say, and I'll come back to that in a moment, but after you have a chance to hear this, a little bit of this, that there is in this music, I think, a kind of emotional search for a new artistic kind of expression, personal, but based on the greatest amount of rigor I could apply to the compositional process. I can tell you in advance that this profound search, which meant so much to me, did not necessarily end in success, as you will find out, in that, in the end, these elegances of structure and form do not in themselves address the existential pain and beauty that I was aiming for. And I think you'll see a little bit of that. Usually composers are not so forthright in their expressing what they say in words about what they're trying to do. I do so because you're mostly mathematicians, it doesn't matter to you. So, no, I'm making a joke. Okay, but you can see actually right from the beginning an attempt to reduce music to a very simple kind of statement. And you're going to see that in this case the pitch D that is found there, that is becomes to be sustained in the violin and is picked up by the other instruments little by little. I'll go along with this so you can follow it. You can see that it is like the horizon line or that x-axis of some sort of upright version of what a symmetry could be. But you're going to see right away that the durational distance between the beginning ones that fall downward and then the other ones that fall downward from an even greater height, the durational spaces between those utterances is not the same, even though the interval content is the same. Okay. And I guess I'll conclude that little introduction by saying, after a concert, very often it happens that someone will come up to me and say either, you know, God, I hate your music, don't ever come back, or more hopefully, I really loved your music, but I don't know anything about music and I don't understand it. I don't know how you do that or what you're doing. And yet I always feel that even persons who don't think they understand what I'm doing experience it in a significant way, because while music does not really have significant verbal analogs, it has a form of cognition or thoughtfulness that even people without the words to describe them, those experiences, do experience. See for yourself. I'll have the trio play just the beginning. And you can see in this little graph just how the symmetries and palindromes are reflected in his analytic approach to the music. What is really fascinating to me about this, as you look at it, when you see it all at once in that way, it takes on a graphic and visual immediacy, which is the way we are comfortable in talking about these matters. But of course, the thing that distinguishes the music from the visual is that music must unfold in time, and time's arrow moves one way. Most mathematics doesn't matter with the way time happens. I mean, there is mathematics of time, to be sure, but the expressions of symmetry are precisely, in mathematics, designed to not take into account that unfolding in that way, typically. In music, there is no other way. So what you are looking at here are actually durations that are being projected, as well as pitches, which exposes us, in effect, to the two principal ways in which music can express symmetry and palindrome. That is, in terms of its pitch content or frequency content, and in terms of its rhythm or durational content. And the durational ones are the ones that go on in time. Now, before this gets too kind of serious and heavy, I thought I'd show you something that's a lot of fun, and then have them demonstrate in music why I think it's a lot of fun. And that is this wonderful YouTube video, which I hope to be able to find pretty quickly. Let's see. And that is okay. It's actually Cat's Cradle. And the second movement of my trio is called Cat's Cradle. It's actually Leggeri con accenti diversi in Italian, but the subtitle is Cat's Cradle, and I'm going to find the one I love, because there's... Ah, there you are. Thank you, ladies. That's it. Let's have a look. You'll all remember this, won't you? You can see that what these girls are doing is, from a single loop of string, they're producing a sequence of symmetrical figures. It's a kind of folk calculus or topology or whatever you'd like to say. It's like kids do it. And of course, how many of you have done that? I'm just curious. I think it's just about universal, isn't it? Everybody does it. I found it's pretty cross-cultural too. It happens just about everywhere. So you get a series of... Of course, the problem is that at a certain point, you've done this a certain amount of times, you start repeating the same pattern. And I remember getting really bored by the time you get to that point, because you want to somehow go consistently find new ones. But it's quite astonishing that this little thing produces so much amusement and such perfect palindromes and symmetry. So here's a little bit of the second movement of my work, called Cat's Cradle, or leggermente, lightly with diverse accents. And I'll show you why it's called that by taking you to the score in a moment here. Okay, there you see it. Okay, this is quite tricky, so we're gonna let our team here, these mammoth players, go for it. Okay, now then I'll explain what's going on. Okay, maths. Thank you. You heard, The symmetry was all around a single pitch, that D that you heard. In the second movement that you just heard, the symmetries are around the dyad or interval that is chosen at the beginning, that F and A flat that you hear articulated very strongly. So these two kinds of symmetries are played off against each other in this way. But the effect in the second, the so-called cat's cradle movement, is interesting because, I'll show you just what that is interesting about that. Okay. I seem to be doing it more and more on my own hook here. You can read my email in the meantime. You know, there's nothing on here. I'm sure, you know, my damn emails. I wish they'd get off the subject. Yes. Okay. These are very famous symmetries, which can be easily seen to be symmetries. In this case, the two faces and the goblet, very famous perceptual question. Because when you see the goblet, you can't see the faces. And when you see the faces, you can't see the goblet. And when the players play Cat's Cradle, you probably experience this much more readily as the composite than you do as the individual strands working independently. And in fact, it's very interesting when I talk to the players about it, because they say, I said, are you hearing this as the composite, or are you counting, you know, every seven beats a new interval? And they all have different answers to that question. Turns out that this kind of fun and games is not unique to Western music. The Pygmy people of Central Africa do this. And many people in Indonesia, in Bali, they do this. It's called the Kotekan, where people play these how many people know the monkey chant? You heard that? Chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk. Well, nobody's doing chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk. Everybody's going chuk-chuk-chuk-chuk on every offbeat. But you perceive this as a very complex composite. So in perceptual symmetries, right? In perceptual symmetries, all kinds of games can be played. And this is a lovely one too. There's many of them. If you look closely at that one, it's not so much a symmetry, but as a problem of composite and individuation. When you look at it, you see the face of a woman. On the other hand, you see a sax player. But it's impossible to see them both at the same time. Everybody getting a problem there? And it's very ingenious, but this should always remind us that art, unlike mathematics in some fundamental way, depends upon a certain kind of perceptual, biological perceptual attentiveness. Without that, it isn't there. And just as a footnote to that, it's always struck me as rather odd. How many people know the book Gödel, Escher, Bach? Right, almost everybody. It was such a popular book for a while. And Douglas Hofstadter's book is interesting. And, you know, Gödel is an amazing genius. Escher, maybe not such an amazing genius, but still, you know, Escher kind of, this is sort of the summation of Escher right here. But Bach, what do we say about this? I tell my students he's extraterrestrial, because not only does he involve the most complex kinds of structural elegances and unbelievable, skillful uses of those formalistic ideas, but the music literally breaks your heart and brings you joy. Now, only mathematicians could look at a really complicated equation and hearts be filled with enthusiasm or deep sorrow to see them. But when we hear the B minor mass or any of the pieces that Bruce was playing, it's not just about that. If the preludes and fugues were just about the skill of making a fugue, they'd be worthless. It's silly, it's no point. And in a sense, that's where music lives. It lives in that non-semantic, cognitive, sensory world, which we can appreciate some of the abstractions anyway, present in our intellectual world of mathematics, but they come to us through the senses in a very sensual and emotional way. This is the time for my piece, and I'm going to shut up, and then I'll come back. I will say that it is in four movements. The first movement, I will go back there to make sure I get all this correctly. So the first movement is Leggermente conoscenti diversi. Oh, that's the second movement. First movement is, okay, Semplice inesorabili, simply and inexorably. The second movement, as I said before, Leggermente conoscenti diversi, or Cat's Cradle. And the third and fourth movements, which are connected. So you're not going to hear a break between the third and fourth movement. What's going to happen is that Lisa's going to play a piano cadenza that will lead us, she will lead us into that fourth movement. Third movement is called Parlando Affettuoso, which means speaking tenderly. All of these, by the way, each of these movements pursues these symmetrical and palindromic aspects kind of ruthlessly in some ways, and getting ever more complex. And finally, the final movement, which I think brings the existential question to a point. And that is called Ardente Sperduto. Ardente is like our English ardently or with great passion. But sperduto, well, in Italian, perdere is to lose, or to be, to perduto is to become lost or something is lost. But sperduto, with an S in front of the P, is about as lost as you can possibly be. That's lost beyond any redemption. So here is the piano trio. It's from 1988, as performed by the wonderful Mammoth Trio. They're Mammoth because of their enormous spiritual size. Okay, I'll get us out of this. Well, maybe I'll just leave this up here. Thank you.
Thank you.
these lovely folks find their comfortable seats, and let me just conclude before Bruce rightfully takes back some of this time. I want to make sure I cover the things I wanted to say. I've talked about I want to show you some funny palindromes. It's always fun. Here's two of my favorites. Sex at noon, taxes. And able was I ere I saw Elba. You can see that palindromes in language exhibit the same fundamental characteristics that they do in music, namely that they really mean something only going in one direction, and when you reverse them, they're still going in the same direction. So it's a kind of a funny thing. They're amusing. In music, they're actually quite similar in music when you do that, but the symmetry is visual, and you can perceive it. But the difference between music and language in this regard, and especially music of any complexity, is that, of course, it depends on durational placement, whereas language does depend on it, but in a much looser way. In other words, the symmetries that you heard that took place in time in that work are very precisely calibrated and would be meaningless without it. Where I could say this fast or slow, and it really wouldn't change the, well, I suppose if I said sex at noon, taxi. I mean, I'd have to, you can see what I'm probably getting to. Okay, so perception, I wanted to make that point. In music, by the way, that kind of palindromic rhythmic structure is referred to as non-retrogradable rhythms. This is something that the great French composer Olivier Messiaen did. That is to say, a rhythm like da-da-da-da-da-da is going to sound exactly the same whether I do it backwards or forwards. Da-da-da-da-da-da. And that rhythm is found very, very powerfully in Janáček's great Sinfonietta in the opening movement, but of course the pitch is changing. Janáček is very alert to that. And finally, I wanted to go back to this thing, which is a point I made before. I didn't talk very much about the axis of symmetry, but I'll leave that alone for now. But I will say something about symmetry as it's understood in physics. You can see that little description there, that H2O, which is a solid as ice, becomes a liquid in water and a gas when it becomes steam. And yet the atomic structure remains exactly the same. It's always H2O. That transposition of something which remains the same into formal qualities that are enormously different. I mean, anybody who's jumped into a pool of ice will tell you how different that is than falling into a cloud, for example. I think now, you know, I think one of the things that happened to me in writing that trio particularly was that this Sperduto part is that I came to the end for myself of this endless search for rigor that would somehow provide an explanation for things. And also from a musical point of view, if we go back to this, which was such an important part of my understanding of symmetry in music, good place to go back. You can see the waveforms. You know, if we take the axis of symmetry to be the exact center of that, we can make very good predictions about what the waveform is going to look like on the other side of that axis. And in music, that kind of predictability can become very constraining. It's an interesting thing. And anecdotally, I was working with my colleague John Chowning on frequency modulation techniques with computers in the early 70s. And at that time, we were very interested in seeing how waveforms could be described digitally. And the computer had a thing called an oscillator. And we were modulating one wave by another, and we were experimenting with the ratios and the size of the modulators compared to the actual carrier frequency. And we discovered that, of course, that you could do things, mentally anyway, where the modulating frequency would cause the frequency itself to dip below zero. And we were very puzzled by that. Audio engineers now know this very well, what happens when you do. Any audio engineers out there? Well, what we had to devise was a thing called a nozzle, which was prepared to accept negative frequencies. You know, negative frequencies is like the kind of Buddhist sound of one hand clapping. I mean, after all, what is a negative frequency? Something that doesn't happen 8 times as opposed to 15 times. But in this world, what happens when you do negative frequencies is that they actually flip over. There's a thing called Bessel functions. God knows I don't want to think too much about that anymore. But there's a thing called Bessel functions, and it proved to us that the frequencies that dip below zero appeared back in their waveforms just with the phase reversed. So they didn't actually disappear, they're just the phase was reversed. Well, you can imagine what that would be like here too. That is, you take a wave and it was going like this, but now it goes like this, and in a sense, it makes a similar predictive circumstance. In the end, after many years of playing with this idea, I felt it actually more stimulating to think about what would happen if you had a kind of sentient, objective idea that could be placed contextually in context so and emerge temporally so with such stimulating vitality, but without losing some element of its characteristics, no matter what form it finally took. And that has led me to a very different place in my music, and one which I'm very glad to have. And those of you who love the music of Debussy, for example, as I do, you will find that unlike his more rigorous comrades of the same era, the Scriabins and the Schoenbergs and so on, it's extremely difficult to track the developmental practices in Debussy because they proceed very much in a different way, and a way that is actually, it's very French. It's very subtle, and it's very flexible. Thank you for listening to me, and now I'll turn this over to Bruce. I know he wants to ask some questions, and I'm happy to do that.
Martin, would you like to, maybe I'll move this chair over for you, and you can sit here.
Okay.
You got it? Yeah, okay, you can bring it through here. You can use this.
Thank you.
So, in the time we have, by the way, bravo, that was a fantastic performance, obviously, really great. We could, I don't know if you closed your eyes during some of the rhythms to see, probably we want to at certain points to see if it sounded different, not seeing people project silent rhythm.
Counting.
We don't have to call it counting. But what I mean is, you know, you can see in the body and the faces, the rhythms you're not hearing. And if you're not looking at it, what does that sound like? Just something to think about. So Martin, my first question is, if we were to distill this whole thing down to one question, which we won't, but here's the first one. It's really about freedom versus constraint. And when you choose all your own constraints and you make your own rules, I mean, some composers throughout history have said that's their favorite thing to do, you know, and you know all about it. So like Stravinsky always talked about how the more restrictions he gave himself, the freer he was to compose. And Hindemith, for example, gave himself a crazy restriction in Hidden Suruk. I'm just looking at you because you're there. I know you know all this stuff. But so I'll look over here. Oh, you know. But anyway, his opera Hidden Suruk, forth and back, and back and forth, doesn't matter. The whole opera goes in one direction, and then all the music goes in the other direction. And the guy who jumped out the window jumps back in the window right at that spot, and everything turns around. And you mentioned Messiaen, who, of course, did work a lot with palindromes in many kinds of ways, both rhythmic and modal. And then he constructed a whole language of his musical processes in order to feel, I guess, free, but maybe for him it was almost theological. So you've already addressed this a little bit, but to distill it down in the simplest way, did you feel that some of the rules that you set up for this piece were constraining, or did you actually feel once you got into it that you could really do whatever you want and still obey your rules?
I've been teaching composition now for many years at Yale. That's what I do in my spare time. I tell my students that the idea is to make any stumbling block into a building block, any resistance place into a place of strength and a place to push off from. In fact, you probably can't write music unless you have some of those. On the other hand, I think you've touched on something that I'd like to return to very briefly, and that is that for Messiaen, these formal ingenuities do have a spiritual and religious connotation for him. And for me, I was reaching for a secular version of what for him has a kind of Catholic spiritual Buddhist thing. For me, I'm not in that world. And for about 10, 12 years after this trio that you all just heard, I wrote pieces that explored almost every variety of this procedural way that I could, trying to import as many affective states into that formality as I could. So I wrote a whole bunch of pieces called Opere della Musica Povera, or Works of a Poor Music, 12 different works, each with a very characteristic title, and either amusing or terrifying, but use the same idea. And as I proceeded further and further in that, the kind of monk-like austerity, that kind of intellectual approach, became ever more burdensome to me for what I wanted to do. And finally, in 2013, I was tasked to write an opera, and I wrote my first real opera, some other theater piece, but nothing extended like an hour and a half, an hour 15 minutes. And I found that in writing the opera, it shattered the last remnants of that formalism for me. And from that time on, even though my pieces retain a certain, you know, characteristic reliance on kind of compositional ingenuity, you know, for audiences, I care less and less whether they know about it, whether, you know, I may never be invited back, I'm sorry to say, as a result of that, but it seemed to be more important to do something as something else. So I just want one more thing about that, if I may. In the end, these choices turn out to be not, I wouldn't want any of my students or anyone else to extrapolate from anything I say here as a requisite. You know, in the end, it's probably much more important that people do what they need to do emotionally and musically, whatever their sensibility tells them to do, rather than to suggest, as for Bach, these were a series of completely codified rules that he had his sons and all his students learn. I never did that, and I don't intend to do that.
So I have two more questions, one for you and then one for the rest of you, and since I'm going to tell them what their questions so they can think about it while we talk. Which has to do with when you have that much counting and all of that to learn, where is your freedom or not freedom? And what happens if you mess something up? How much does it bother you as it would in a compared to a piece where it's not so restrictive? And this is just something to talk about. It's not like, you know, don't worry about Martin. He's not going to do anything to you, maybe to you, but not to the rest. Okay, so then basically my question is this. A lot of what we're talking about sometimes comes up in the expression pre-compositional, which for the people in the audience who are not composers, or the word pre is misused a lot in English. For example, in the grocery store, you have pre-sliced mushrooms. You see what the problem is there? They're sliced. They're not pre-sliced. Pre-sliced would be not sliced. This is a huge problem in English, not for me personally. Pre-compositional, you know, I studied with Milton Babbitt for a while, and Milton Babbitt was the epitome of almost every kind of the idea of pre-compositional thinking, and although he didn't force anyone to do it, and also a total organization for him. He didn't make anyone do that, but organization of pitch and of rhythm and of dynamics and articulation, everything, timbre, was pre-organized, which gives it, ironically, a kind of random quality, don't you think? So my question is, does the word pre-composition have a meaning for you, or do you think it is meaningless? And what about postmodernism? They're just kidding. Well,
no, I mean, no. The short answer is no. The longer answer, which I'll only give you the sort of extended short answer, is that even in the piece that you just heard, which is so formally conceived. The concept there is of a paradigm that is articulated at the beginning of the piece whose implications are for me significant and profound and require that I work them out as I go. So they're not worked out before I start. On the other hand, I'm a great student of the music of the past, and particularly Beethoven. Beethoven is a composer for whom a single deformation or oddity in the very beginning of a work carries with it implications that were going to be realized, 45 minutes later, you will understand what that was about, why that happened. And that is sort of more than Bach for me, actually, although the piece you just heard is probably more rigorous than that. But more than Bach is that Beethovenian sense that once you start it, its implications have to be pursued to the last ringing change, which means that it's the start that's so important. And your recognition of the potentiality, even in a very simple thing. I mean, the trio begins in the simplest possible. I mean, it's hard to imagine, like getting a practice room, really, just trying out things. And the implications of that statement are worked out over the course of the entire composition. So it's really not that I sit down beforehand and make a chart, but it's also true that as I'm writing something in the present, my mind is also writing its conclusion in the future.
But I guess part of my question is, once you start, let's say, with the rhythm of the fives and the nines and the strings, you wouldn't, in the middle of that, decide, oh, hell with that, all right?
No, I would never do that. Right. That's not my thing. Right. That's like cheating in solitaire. why cheat? I need a colored card. Oh, well, that's not going to happen. There's no point. What's the point?
I've seen people cheating in video games.
That's not that didn't interest me. And actually, I should say that one of the reasons why that doesn't interest me is because I studied with the great Hungarian composer György Ligeti. He was my master, really. And Ligeti, famously, he took me aside because I was having trouble, and he said, I have to tell this anecdote. Sorry, forgive me. People here know Ligeti's music. You might have heard it in the film 2001. They just had a big festival at the Philharmonic called Ligeti Ford. He's a great, great composer. Hungarian, a master of the late 20th century, early 21st century. He's now gone, unfortunately. But he recognized that when I studied with him, that he had a smart-ass student who was capable of like writing a piece that spelled bingo in three dimensions, and he got kind of irritated with that. And he showed me, I was just working on a section, and I showed him the section and said, Martin, this sounds terrible. Why do you write this bar? And I said, well, it's because the retrograde, it's turned upside down, and you have a, palindrome with the time point of the blah, 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 blah. And he looked at me and he said, Martin, from now on, you may not write an ugly bar. It is not permitted. No, I'm sorry. Cannot write an ugly bar. And what he was saying when he said that was not that you should not try the most hair-raising formalistic plan, but you may not justify anything that happens in your piece on the basis of some abstract formalistic principle. So,
okay.
If you screw up and you get a bad bar, you don't just, take a note from somewhere else, I think I'll just smudge that one up a little bit. You start all over again, so you make sure everything works from the beginning.
The only thing I'm hearing underneath this that I have to ask you about, I don't want to go off in a far direction, we'll come right back. You keep saying formalism versus something else. You sound like you're in the Soviet Union.
Yeah, I resemble that remark.
Okay, let's not get into that. If you don't know,
let's not go there.
Look it up. You look it up. Formalism.
I have been known to be guilty of the most extreme formalism. There's no question about it.
But you can do that here and survive.
You could, yeah. Although you end up writing articles like, "Who cares if you listen?"
But that wasn't the time.
The spirit of the article remains the same.
Since you mentioned Milton, that was Milton Babbitt's famous article.
Yeah.
One time when I was studying him when I was 16, I read something he wrote mathematical about one of his pieces, and I couldn't understand it at all. And I have to say, I showed it to a person, a friend of mine, who knew math extremely well. as he said, you know, give me a day to look at this. This is really intense. And he called me back the next day and said, everything's correct, everything works, but anyone who could do that, write that article, could have written it much more simply. I don't know why he did that. So I come back shaking to my last window, and I open the article. It goes, good grief, what are you doing with that? I wrote that for my job at Princeton. This is Juilliard. Anyway, so now I'd like to hear from the performers, and we'll end with this because it'll be fun and difficult. What is the relationship of exactitude to freedom, and how do you feel, and have you ever played it, which I think happens all the time, but have you ever played it, this or something not quite right, and it's still great, in fact, better than it might have been if you were, you know, this sort of thing?
Well, first of all, this piece, I love this piece. And I knew it before I even knew Martin, and so, and it just, I always wanted to play it. So every note, when it's in the right place, sounds fantastic. So when you're in the wrong place, it doesn't sound so good. And it's frustrating. I mean, that's the thing for all classical musicians that are playing notated music, precisely notated music. You have to be in the right place. You have to count, and you have to be in the right place. And that. So, but is that confining? I mean, that's what we do. So that's the genre that we're in. We're not going out playing jazz solos, and you know. But even then, they have their confines in different places. And whenever you play with a group, you are more. You're very dependent on each other. So you create this situation where you rely on each other. And actually, it went really well tonight. We didn't have any train wrecks. And this piece, you can have train wrecks. But everybody is a really solid counter, and people just, we stayed with it. And also we had landmarks so that if things were to go wrong, that we would know. And we know the places because every two measures there's a D, and every you know, 12 beats there's an A flat. He has these the things that he's talking about, the formalism. It's easily recognizable from us, too. So that helps us to keep us together as well.
So let me just follow up on that a little bit. Is it possible for a performance of this piece, and I'm just using this piece because this is tonight's piece, it could be many, many pieces, obviously, to be slightly off, but still better because it's live than a perfect recording of this piece?
Sure, and that's what's great about live performance, I think. Yeah, is that there's a palpable energy on stage and spontaneous things happen. We've all performed this different amounts of times. This is my third time performing that, and I think it speaks to what you were saying earlier too about like, there's also the journey of a piece with a performer or with a group, and part of it, it becomes more and more freeing. I think each time I do this, and there's something about groove and about being rhythmically confined that actually opens you up once you've been doing it enough. And especially if we're thinking and breathing and feeling as one, which is the goal and the ideal, then a lot of wonderful things can happen. Either we're magnificently off or we're magnificently on. And I think that's part of the fun of it. And also just, you know, I hate making mistakes in general, and especially in Martin's music, he writes difficult music, but nothing ever impossible. And so for me, each time I tackle this piece, it's a challenge of my ability to focus and also my endurance as a player and strength as a player. So, you know, I made mistakes tonight, but...
I must stay in this room. Take that out of the video.
But, you know, each time I feel like, okay, yeah, I got that this time, you know. I feel like all three of us probably feel that there's this journey and this kind of, the learning of it makes everything more free in the end.
Okay. Ali, do you want to say something? You want to tell us which mistakes you made?
Sure. So, I think that...
Closer.
Okay, are we good? Okay, so I think it's a lot about how much time you spend on this, so the more you explore this piece, I feel like, at least for me, a lot of these rhythms come instinctively, so once you're on the groove, you're kind of doing this without thinking almost, and then the more time you spend with it, also the more you can hear it, even when you're not playing it. So I almost kind of hear it in my head first and then use the music kind of as a cheat sheet, actually, so just in case something goes wrong, to see where the pillars are. But it's also so worth the time, because when it's right, it's something special, and especially because it's so difficult, so it's so worth it.
That's great. Yes, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say that, too, you know, we were talking in rehearsal about, you were saying a little bit about us moving and asking, you know, we're so sort of visually counting and demonstrating or demonstrative. But we were discussing in rehearsal, we've only played together a few times now, this is a new trio. So we were saying how nice it would be if, you know, we had oodles and oodles of rehearsal time, and let's say we took this on tour and did only this piece, that would be the next step and the next sort of challenge, I think, for this piece, is eliminating maybe some of that physical movement. But of course it's hard because it's three people trying to be one internal metronome. I think that would be a fun experiment to get to that place.
And I also think that I don't come from the school of let's not move. You know, I mean,
I don't know anyone who comes from
that. But there are classical musicians that don't, you know, they're just, oh, we don't really need, you know, that's a big cue, you don't need to do that sort of thing.
Oh, okay.
You know, and just, it is what it is. Living human beings.
I have no problem with the movement. It's just when we're discussing rhythm, and exactly how it fits together, and you could see some of it. I was thinking when you close your eyes, you hear it differently. I would imagine if you did what you just described, that you would still move, but the movements would change into something completely different. They would probably be groove movements rather than, you know, beating.
Yeah, well, you can think of this, that's the challenge, is to get to thinking it in the half measure, not every quarter note. But that takes a lot of confidence.
But
you can do it in rehearsal, but then you get up and you do
nerves and everything.
You want to take the scale down smaller so that
But I guess it would be somewhat of a magic trick, you know, not to see it. I mean, and I think that would be.
Well, you know, Stravinsky said that he liked watching musicians play, and he never closed his eyes at a concert. He had to see them. I never looked into why he said that, but I sort of understand. I think it's, in some ways with live music, it's really part of the fun, and it does, in a way, inform what's going on. I think I did close my eyes for a while. Of course, I already heard it. I also heard it many years ago. But it did change it, and I actually enjoyed watching it more than just listening to it because of only the accidental choreography that is. It's great. Now, I think we have to end with Martin saying something, words of wisdom, instructions.
Well, no, I just hope that folks out there, in listening to the responses of these wonderful musicians, you've brought back to us again just how corporeal the realization of music is. That is, you know, however intellectually elegant it might appear or might be, it has its reason that it grabs us and moves us in its uniquely musical way is because it's part of the body, it's part of the ear, and the ear is near the heart. And these all things are working together. So it's that unique combination of the cognitive and the corporeal that makes, I think, it's such a deep thing for humans. I love math, and I love thinking about math, and I love thinking about physics, and I love thinking about the way the universe works. And I love thinking about that, and I now, as I've aged, also realize even more profoundly what a mortal being I am, occupying this physical body whose response to the world is filtered through my human, purely, and maybe all too human, ear and mind. So thank you for paying attention to us tonight.